So of course, for my speakers, my coaches, and my consultants, if you're looking to, you know, establish your authority, looking to build your credibility, and even take your voice and turn it into a profitable business, then I would encourage you to go to getpaidwithpodcasting.com. There you can sign up for the free training that we have coming up. Welcome to the Your Podcast Mentor Show with Jonathan Jones. Here you will learn how to start, launch, and monetize your podcast. In addition to hearing the latest trends and the latest and greatest things happening in the podcast industry. Are you ready? What's going on, family? Welcome to the Your Podcast Mentor Show. I'm your host, Jonathan Jones, and this is your go-to spot for podcast news, podcast how-tos, and of course, we got to roll out the interviews. It just makes sense. It just makes sense. And today we have a special guest in the building. We have a special guest virtually, and he's the host of Life on the Court with Antwon Harris, and he also is your motivational coach, the one, the only, Coach Antwon Harris. Coach, how we doing?
Doing great. Thanks for having me, Jonathan.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Most definitely. Glad to have you in the building virtually. You know, glad to have you in the building virtually. But go ahead and just take a few minutes and just introduce yourself to those who may not be familiar with you or your work as of yet.
All right. Yeah. Thank you for that. My name is Antwon Harris, founder and CEO of the Antwon Harris Group, where we help reimagine the future of education. We work with students with student development, and we work with educators with teacher development. Like Jonathan said, I also have my own podcast, and I am a former college basketball coach, former collegiate athlete, student athlete, and also a former teacher educator at the middle and high school level.
Man, yeah, man, you got that resume stacked up, man. You got that thing stacked up. I didn't even know. So now you're talking about reimagining education, and this is not coming from the perspective of somebody on the outside looking in. This is from somebody who was, you know, in the trenches working with the students daily. So talk a little bit about your previous experience and why this is something that you want to do now.
Great. That's a great question. So my previous experience with students in their education, let's just kind of date back to when I was in school and my siblings were in school. And, you know, with schools, it's just a lot of content pushing. And then what I realized over time, listening to people going through college, kind of like playing school, it really didn't develop me or prepare me for what the world had for me, what was out there. So it was once I went again, I was under this bubble for so long, so I didn't notice it. Being in athletics and being a player, you're just kind of under this umbrella, which you really kind of get shielded from a lot of things. But once I finally got out of it, got into education, and I'm a little bit more mindful and woke, so to speak, I started to see the deficiencies in the educational system, the deficiencies with students of color, students that look like me, and how the content is pushed and how different students are being taught different ways. And it rubbed me the wrong way. I was able to move into a position where I was the leader of teachers. I was the curriculum coordinator. So I had some autonomy in my last position to be able to help coach these teachers on how to, hey, you're going to have to build a relationship with these students first, caring before content and grace before grades. So it's when doing that, I just, again, discovered a bunch of deficiencies. And then when the pandemic hit, they talked about learning loss, but I saw a loss of learning before the pandemic, before the pandemic started, just with my own students. So I started to put them in different areas of just mindfulness, emotional management, with them not even knowing, just intertwining that into the lessons, which is hard to do, which is more work for the teachers. However, on the back end of it, you're going to get a more balanced, principled, caring student. And building that classroom culture and student engagement was huge for me. And I've taught multiple subjects, but doing the extra work at home that a lot of teachers are not going to do. Some are in it for the wrong reasons, let's just be honest. And these students, they suffer. And it's kind of, they're just pushed through and they get out in this world and are lost. When I finally got from under the umbrella of athletics, I admit I was lost. I didn't know who Antwon was away from ball. And a lot of our athletes go through that. So I took it upon myself like, all right, how can I, or what can I do to help students kind of identify themselves, who they are, how they work with others in school? So working with a company 24/7 that I'm certified to do the DISC assessment, and they have it for students. A lot of companies don't have that. So just using that as just kind of a baseline, because what I do is how I, my framework, and I'm going to share this with everybody. Yes, my framework is evidence-based learning. Evidence-based strategies, where we start with assessment and then we go through these levels of planning, implementation, and reflection on it to be able to help these students over the course of a semester or a year, just to learn more about themselves. And a lot of it hasn't happened. I have a daughter who graduated in 2021. She graduated high school and was stuck. She struggled in the pandemic and it was hard for her. So that motivated me even more. It's like, all right, I got to do more. Like my own daughter, this hit home for me. And now I'm going to be an agent of change in this area. This is my arena. I love working with students. I love building relationships with students. And I, you know, it comes off as not doing work to me. It's a passion of mine. So that's what I was kind of been led to, literally called by God to do it.
Wow. Wow. First of all, you ain't just going to run past everything that you just said. And I'm saying that because I didn't even notice about you. Like, as you're unpacking this and as you're breaking down this evidence-based framework or evidence-based learning, I'm like, wait, what? And then you talking about the DISC assessment too, man. Like, okay, so this I'm just gonna let everybody in on this, because what one might think when they see you on Instagram, because I told you offline, I say every time I look up, I see you. You're speaking somewhere else because you are, and now I can see why it's solidified. I'm gonna bring it full circle, and I'm gonna get a mic back to you. I'm bringing full circle.
Okay, I love it,
because people have to understand in order to get in certain rooms. Right. In order to get in certain rooms, there is a level of status that you have to have. And you just said, one, you've identified the problem that you've seen teachers have when you were working within the school system. Yeah. Two, you said you were a curriculum coordinator. You're literally holding the keys to the city, right? Yes. In terms of like what's being taught, what needs to be retained, and then walking people through strategy of what it takes to do that. On top of the fact that you're DISC certified, and then you're doing the work within the work, because facilitating a DISC assessment is one thing, but then being able to break down like what it means, and then understanding that certain people need to learn information certain ways. So we take all of that and put all that together. On top of the fact that you were a former athlete and then working with students who are athletic, and then also, you know, students who are I don't like to say just students, but you know, students, you know. Oh, you know, you put all of that together, that makes a strong package. Now I see why you booked and busy, man. Now I see.
And I don't, you know, because when I'm on social media, right, I know it can be difficult because I'm just not experienced at it. To be honest with you, I know what I can do. I know I can get on the phone and I can talk about what we do. I know what I can do. I know I can build relationships with individuals. I know I could email you and give you detail on what we're doing, what we're trying to do, and here's what it looks like from A to Z. I can do that. Now, you know, again, you don't really see it on Instagram and stuff like that. I mean, I do a lot more on LinkedIn. So it's, you know, it's a little bit different, but And that's just where I'm at with it. Like I'm in this, just this business of helping students, and I'm passionate about it. And I just really want to start with self. And that's where the self-equity program comes in for these students. Yep, going to start with the DISC. If you want the DISC assessment, cool, we can only do the DISC. But if you want to go beyond that with the self-equity program, where we touch on mindfulness, where we touch on resiliency, communication, emotional management, and a couple other things throughout an entire semester or the entire school year, then we can do that too. Because my thing is, I want to, again, reimagine the future of education, and then that helps students reimagine their own future. It helps teachers reimagine how they can teach. For an example, I'm headed out to California at the end of the month to present to the English teachers of the state of California on creating safe spaces for collaborative learning and student engagement. I'm passionate about that. I said it previous and just in this interview earlier. I know how to create that space and help keep students engaged over a class period and beyond. Because one of the things that has to happen is that we, in the educational system, that we have to have learning go beyond the classroom walls. And if I can tap into the DISC assessment with elementary students, if I can tap into ninth graders when they come to high school about, like, who am I, learning more about themselves, it goes back to content, but students aren't really knowing about themselves. They're just sitting here lined up and being told what to do. And for me, I've had a student-centered classroom, which allows for discussions, opinions, debates, because we all come from different backgrounds and you're able to learn from one another. I learn from students learn from me. I'm the expert at it, cool. Doesn't mean I can't be a student as well, because we all know when you stop being a student, that's when basically you die. Some people, and I like to say that some people die at 18, but don't get buried until they're 82. So, which is unfortunate. But Wow. You got to keep learning.
Wow. Yeah, man. This is good. I'm taking notes over here. So when you see me looking
down, I'm
taking notes, because I want to just highlight some things that you've said that I think can really help some other people. But it's the fact that, one, you have the goal, and the goal is to help reimagine education, right? So You're coming with something unique. And I'm going to say it like this, because I'm just going to say it like this. You know, I'm not saying it to offend anybody, but
right.
You're because the Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. So you're Absolutely. Bringing education, right? Education is not new, but you're bringing the Antwon Harris version of education to people, to the Absolutely. Students. And they're like, oh, well, you know, we've been doing education, but we want that type of education. So, man, so for the people out there, I want them, y'all got to get your thing, right? You got to get your, you got to get your twist, like how Antwon has reimagined education. But then let's go a little bit deeper on what you said, Antwon, because you said you can get the DISC, or you said you can come and get, so you can get the fries, or you can get this whole combo.
You can get the whole combo.
Because you said you got more offerings.
I have more offerings with the self-equity program. Again, that DISC assessment, the students are going to learn about themselves. And here's the unique part about it, right? Talk about being different. For the students, the DISC assessment, the students are going to get literature. Their parents are going to get literature. Their teachers are going to get literature. Their coaches, counselors are all going to get literature about that one student, And then if you, in the educational space, we talk about differentiation. We talk about being able to group certain kids with other kids. We can group kids based on the DISC. Somebody with a D-I-S-E have those grouped together and see how that turns out. Again, what we're saying, some may argue that the way education is done, it doesn't work. So let's just, I like to do this, reimagine the future of education. So now adding the depth of the self-equity program. In one sentence, let me describe self-equity as basically solving your problems using your thoughts, ideas, creativity, knowledge, and self-control. We have built equity in so many other places, our homes, our financial portfolio, social equity. If you're in sports, sweat equity, right? But nobody really focuses on self equity so that you're able to just learn more about you, expand who you are, and just know how you can navigate, pivot through this world. Let's think of the underserved community. All right, Black community, kids of color. If you don't have the funds, resources to go get counseling, I can help you with some tips, tools, and strategies that's going to be able to help you bring yourself back to baseline, right? So that you're able to make a more conscious, informed decision, choice with your life. And that's what it is. And the way with this, it's when you build equity in yourself, it's pandemic proof. It's recession proof. You can't borrow against your self-equity. Your self-equity can't be stolen. It can't be destroyed in a natural disaster unless you pass away. It can't be taxed. And guess what? It's available 24/7. The only time your self-equity doesn't work is when you don't let it. That's the only way it doesn't work, unless you don't let it. Unless you call in sick on yourself. Unless you're not there for you. Right? Unless you're not present. So, you know, that's what it is. You know, you can't, nothing new under the sun, but it's a billion something people on this planet. It's only one you. And that person can't be copied. So let's work on building equity within ourselves. And you know, that's my message for students. Man. And then guess what? That's gonna go even beyond, right? I'm starting with the meat and potatoes with the students, but yes, it can go with teachers. It can go anywhere. A lot of people can build equity within themselves, but let me start with the babies, man. Let me start with the babies.
That makes a lot of sense, man. As you keep on talking about what, just know what you've put together, and you know, with your experience and talking about self-equity, Antwon, I gotta ask you, man, because you keep on talking about this program, which I think is phenomenal. How does one begin to create a curriculum?
It's based off of all those things that I said. Ideas, creativity, experience, accumulated knowledge, and the expertise in the field of education, in the field of students. When we look at the world around us, what's missing? Empathy, right? Being able to put yourself in someone else's shoes, being able to see what they see and being able to feel what they feel. But it's not being taught. And again, you look around the world, you look at information, you look at misinformation, you look at how people talk, how arguments happen, debates, and it's like, no, they always say cooler heads prevail, but no one is sacrificing to be the cooler head. So again, my own experiences, I was a hothead at some point. Like, yeah, my junior year, I led the league in technical fouls. You know what I'm saying? Like, going through life hasn't been easy, but it's just like, you gotta somehow figure it out. And then I work with a ton of people. Man, I can't take a lot of credit for it. First of all, the man upstairs dropped it in my spirit, but it's just like he has put people in my line to work with. I have a lady who I work with at University of Georgia. I got a couple colleagues that I still work with and talk to, but just these people who, hey, Antwon, you thought about this? That are in my line, who are volunteering to just, they see the vision, they believe in it, and they wanting to help. So it hasn't been on me. It's, you know, a ton of research, again, using my own experiences with students, with families, communities, with teachers, and my own family to be able to move these things forward. But it's not easy. It's just a lot of hard work. It's a lot of smart work. So yeah, it's a lot of conferences. Like I think about almost every conference that I went to as an educator. It's like, it's things that are able to tie back into to help students with. I went to a social emotional learning conference. I went to they have these, I think these different practices in school. I forgot the name of that, but and a lot of content conferences, but just able to just, again, learn from other colleagues over the years and retain that information. I got books, I got notes. I do read. A lot of people, I don't know if they do read, but like that's where the success and the secrets are, is in the reading, in my opinion. And I've become an avid reader. So yeah, educational books. I mean, I'm a big movie watcher, right? Mm-hmm. But I also like to extract lessons from movies. I don't watch just the entertainment. I look at different quotes because these people who are writing and directing these movies, they're very smart. And what can I extract? What lesson can I extract from this? What the evolution of this character, does it remind me of anybody in my life? But again, that all goes back to accumulated knowledge, ideas, creativity, my experiences in life. And then with the resources of others, being able to develop something like this.
Yeah, man. That's dope. That's dope. Because, you know, with your own experience, that's where the uniqueness is in your story. So, yeah, that's super cool. So since you brought it up, let's go ahead and rewind back and just tap dance a little bit. Like with you being, bro, you made it to the Hall of Fame. How's it feel to be in a Hall of Fame? Like what
does that feel like? Oh man, woo! Listen, it caught me off guard, caught me by surprise, and I'm so grateful and thankful because I've always lived and played with a chip on my shoulder. Because growing up, I just knew nothing was going to be given, everything was going to be earned, and I always felt like, just in the moment, I kept it to myself. I never got the credit that I deserve, ever, right? And even though, you know, I led my teams in scoring, rebounding, the captain on the team, you know, all these wins over my 4 years of college ball, and still never thought I got the credit that I deserved. But that was an internal flame that just kept burning. So it's just like, I'm just continue to work, get better at being better. And when I got that news January of 2020, I think January 13th of 2020, I about cried. I was like, wow, finally, you know? And again, this is after a ton of awards at the junior college level of first team All-American. I had like multiple MVP awards in one season and, you know, leading my team to a record of 34-2 and a third place finish in the national tournament at the NJCAA Division I level. It was crazy, you know, going Division I after that, it was crazy, I was like, man, finally I got the credit that I feel like I deserved. And that's being in the immortal and the Hall of Fame. So that eternal fame, man, it's just over the years, people, what they said, what they did, how things were talked about has always been logs on my fire, and I just, you know, kept it burning.
So from taking all those experiences, you know, from you being a basketball player, from you being a teacher and you being a coach, and then now you transition over to the other side, and then you start up this podcast. Talk a little bit about that. Talk a little bit about why you decided to do the podcast, and you know, just how that's impacted you with like within your business and everything like that.
Yes, I have to be honest. I got to give a ton of credit to you, my friend. And just like a lot of moving parts were going on, but I talk about, you know, what I wanted to be speaking and having these opportunities, which again, those have been coming, but it's like, I need to be able to speak often, right? How can I do that? But again, I had it on Anchor. I didn't launch it until August of last year. That stuff was in the queue back in January. I was like, what was I waiting for? But it was you just kind of, you know, going through the 5-day to getting started, and just how you did it, the things that you said, you really empowered me to just get started, and things you'll learn on the way. But it was you, bro. It was you, just again empowering me, and I'm just sitting back and just watching, along with trying to do everything else. I'm just sitting back watching. I'm taking notes. Like, yep, I just got to do it. Like season one, I had zero video. I just started video season two. I just started, but I just like, I need to be speaking every single week. I need to be able to give something. And first, how it started with, it was just going to be me. But my college roommate and teammate won a fight, a heavyweight fight that was on pay-per-view. He beat someone that was undefeated. And I was like, I got to interview him about this. Like, wait, we got to talk about this. So fresh off of that, I was like, all right, maybe let me get some guests and let me see. Let's talk about life in their court and what it originated from, because I struggled with the name. Life on a Court has been a memoir of mine. This is my high school year, all 4 years. This is my junior college years, Life on the Court. These are been created for years. And this is my time at Winthrop, my life on the court. So then it's like, how can I do a play on words where let's talk about life in their court? And that's just your regular life. Your court could be as an educator, as a student, professional athlete, artist, painter, music. That's your court that you're working in. So how can I get someone on and talk about life in their court and being able to give some info, some gems to the audience, the listening audience, to be able to learn from their story, their journey. And, you know, that's what I've just been doing. Just, again, my creativity. I'm just sitting back. I pray, meditate. And when I do those things, God just be like, boom, he drops it. There it is, son. Work it. That's what I've been doing. Like, seriously, that's what I've been doing.
Man, that's super dope. I'm learning all the behind the scenes stuff today. I had no idea, man, that you had. Wow, that you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like you manifested it, right? Because it's like
seriously,
you were taking some action, and then it just came to time. So what was the thing? What was the thing to where like? Because I mean, yeah, you went through the challenge and everything like that. But what was the part to where you really told yourself, I have to flip this switch? Because like you said, you had it up on Anchor and everything like that, but you just didn't pull the trigger. What was it within you to where you were like, it has to, like, it's now or never?
I gotta keep speaking. I gotta speak. If I'm not being booked for speaking engagements, I can't control if somebody says yes, I can control what I put out though. I can control my message. I can control how I add value to the lives of other people. And so let's do that. And that's what I wasn't thinking about. And it was just and it was just another avenue to, on a grand scheme of things, yeah, this can eventually be a stream of income. How great would that be? But at the same time, it's like, let me put the value, let me add value to me, let me add value to the business, let me add value, and then everything else will fall into place. So it's, I mean, I love it. I love it, every bit of it. And it was now or never, because it's like, I got to get better. I need to get better at being better. And what is something that I can do consistently every single week on the same day that keeps me going, that keeps me honest, that keeps me disciplined? And it's that. It holds me accountable every single week. Because I'm a big believer in, I say these three things. I either say the real CDC or the CDC you can trust. And that's commitment, that's discipline, and that's consistency. Those three things you can count on, no matter who's saying what. You go by that, you're going to be just fine. So yeah.
Man, that's strong. That's strong. I see you with another framework, laying out another framework for us.
I did, man. I know you didn't ask for it, but man, I want to add as much value to this cast, because I'm so thankful that for you to have me on, man. It means a lot. But yeah, I just want to be able to add value to your listening audience.
Man, well, we definitely appreciate it. I want to ask you this, because this was something we talked about a little bit offline, and I think the people need to hear it, especially for those people who are, you know, aspiring speakers, aspiring coach, consultant, whatever it might be. You go by the name Your Motivational Coach, but you're not all about the motivation. You got to break it down, man.
Okay,
break it down.
I'm not sure if I even figured it all out yet, but I say you're a motivational coach because the motivation can come in so many different areas. It can come from me speaking in front of people. It can come on a conversation, motivated after a conversation. It can come from somebody just sitting back and seeing what I'm doing on social media, or sitting back and just watching how I went from this to this and be motivated by my actions. So I just want to be able, and you know, again, something from you. You said your podcast mentor. That's powerful to me. That's so powerful. So how could I, you know, kind of like make it so empowering when they get an email or I sign, and it's mainly, I don't really say it on social media at all. I don't say your motivational coach. What I say, I put it in my email. So I don't use it as much, but just being able to have, again, just something. Like, what is something powerful that I can just say about me? Oh, I'm your motivational coach. And that could be for your students. That could be for your educators. That could be for you personally. That could be for when you just, anybody who's just kind of sitting back and just watching, you know, because we all know some people, a lot of people may not like it, but they watching. So, but yeah, I mean, you have inspired me a lot. You just have. And I appreciate it.
Coach Harris, that's, well, I mean, first of all, I appreciate the, you know, the flowers, you know, much love and much respect.
Yeah.
But from hearing you say that makes me think of like you being the, like, your motivational coach. It ties full circle into what you're doing with self-equity, because it creates a level of ownership, but then it also goes to the relationship piece that you've been talking about. Because it's like, who's that? Oh, that's, you know, your motivational coach. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like
I appreciate it.
It ties together, man. And it falls into what you've been saying this whole time. Like, about the relationship, creating accountability, and all that wrapped up in there, man. It makes so much sense. Full circle.
I appreciate that. I just thank God. I really do. I just thank God because I jumping off and the way I did it, Jonathan, the way I did it was just like, God was like, just go do it. The world is shut down. Hit the ground running. And, I mean, like I said, over time, I've been doing these things with my students for years, but it was time to cover more ground. And I've seen the success with my own students in the classroom, how they are in the community. Why in the community? Because I will go to their games and watch them play in different sports and their performances. And I've gotten phone calls, emails from parents basically talking to me like, man, thank you what you're doing with my son, with my daughter. They think it's the world of you. And, I've had a ton of calls, emails, text messages with that. And it just reaffirmed that, yeah, I'm doing things the right way. And I'm showing them a different avenue. I'm showing them a different way of life, a different style of living. And I look like them. Right? There's not a lot of Black male teachers in education. And it's like, there is a market for me to come in and be your educational consultant because there are white males and white females doing it. Let me come in and work because you're working with students who look like me. Let me help you help them, which will help your community moving forward. So yeah, that's what I've been. Like I said, I'm not the best on social media, but when I am locked in with my colleagues and we have these meetings about how we can be better, when research comes in from my colleague at the University of Georgia, it's like, and she's in, she does a lot of stuff with online learning and student engagement, like, yeah, let's put these heads together and let's kind of help roll this thing out. One of the things that I'm going to share this one time, and nobody else is going to, I'm not going to share it again until we roll it out. But so you get an exclusive. We're going to roll out augmented reality. Here's what I mean by that, right? Research shows that students are more engaged in a VR and AR situation. So to make the company pandemic proof, right? We don't know what's going to happen. No one knew that schools was going to shut down. People were going to be home. Kids were going to have to raise themselves for 2+ years. So let's prepare for it and have that available for the students who are in need for the self-equity program. But we're just going to roll some things out. And everybody's like, oh, you're talking about metaverse and stuff. Like that. I was like, no, you'll just have to see it roll out. It's not you're able to get a physical person, but in a different way of seeing them run you through these small groups, these discussion questions, these activities that's going to help build your self-equity. So excited about that. That's an exclusive. So the people come back and watch this, they're going to get it. And again, that's another thing that just, again, adding more value to the business. We don't know where the world is going to go, but it's good to be prepared for it. So that's what I'm trying to do.
Man, that's so strong. That's strong. That's strong right there, Coach Harris. That's strong. Let people know where they can find you, how they can follow you, and how they can connect with you, please.
Yes. Thank you for that. You can visit my website at www.antwonharris.com. You can also find me on Facebook at Antwon R. Harris or my regular name, Antwon Harris, both. You can find me on Instagram at coach.aharris. And on Twitter, you can find me at Antwon Harris 21. And Antwon is spelled A-N-T-W-O-N. And you can email me at info@antwonharris.com.
There we go. There we go. I'm going to make sure to get that information from you. And so we can put it down in the show notes for, you know, for the listeners and for the viewers. But before I let you get out of here, I got to run you through some questions. I like to have a little fun segment. I like to call this segment this or that. Right. So you're going to pick one option or the other. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's go.
Okay. Okay. And here we go. Coke or Pepsi?
Pepsi.
Beaches or mountains?
Ooh. Beaches. That was tough. I'm an outdoors guy, man. Like, I'm big into nature.
Yeah, I feel that. Here we go. Under Armour or Reebok?
Ooh, UA.
Hamburgers or tacos?
Tacos.
Work hard, play hard.
Dang, I gotta pick one. Man, I'm a play, baby. I'm bringing the energy.
There we go. See, that was it. That was it.
That was the hardest, man. I like to work because I like to work smart. I like to work smart. Now, if you'd have said work smart or play hard, I'm taking work smart all day.
That's good, man. That's good. Well, now I want to ask you this last question, and then I'm gonna kick it back to you once again for the final thought. But who's one slept on podcaster that I should interview next?
Who's one slept on podcaster? Man, you may have interviewed her already. Hold on. My girl, hold on, because I have her on my Bren.
Oh, Coach Bren?
Coach Bren.
Okay, Coach Bren. Good. I recorded her. I haven't shot out the interview, so it's right on time. It works out.
Coach Bren, yeah. I like the mental advantage. Like I have a lot that's saved on here. But hers is slept on. There's another one. And I met these young ladies at a Pitch Masters competition. Are you familiar with Pitch Masters?
It's like a
lower level Shark Tank. But these ladies that have Beauty-ish Radio, that's a podcast that I recently been listening to, and I think it's slept on. Yeah.
Okay, good. I'll look them up and I'll reach out. That's good to know.
Yeah, Beauty-ish Radio.
Okay. There it is. Okay, I got you. I'll look them up. And Coach Harris, I definitely enjoyed our time today, our dialogue today. What's a final word that you want to leave with the people? You gave us a lot of gems. You even gave us a dime exclusive. Okay. But what's a final word you want to leave with the people?
You know what? Whatever you do in life, for me, it's reimagining the future of education. And the time is now. No opportunity wasted to reimagine the future of education and reimagine the future of you. So let's go. No time wasted.
That's good.
No opportunity wasted. Let's go.
Yeah, that's good. Well, man, this has been a jam-packed episode. Everybody out there listening. I want to just encourage you all. I want to encourage you all, definitely connect with Coach Harris. We're going to have his information down in the show notes. So be sure to connect with him. And then also, so we can continue to grow the platform and create more exposure for other phenomenal individuals, be sure to rank and review the podcast at yourpodcastmentorshow.com. But this ultimately is Your Podcast Mentor Show with Jonathan Jones, where the focus is to where we help you establish your platform so you can profit on purpose from your podcast. See you next time. Peace and God bless.